I hold the hands of the woman who is responsible for carrying out the plan of God for my existence in the earth. My mother. The same hands that have embraced me as an infant and an adult in times of triumph and trouble, letting me know you are present because your touch is distinct from any other woman. These hands I hold have been through some hard times. Some of the stories I may never know, but I feel the texture of victory and the spirit of resilience as your body and mind persevere through all of the changes taking place. I can only imagine what is going on inside of you, because at one time I was there inside of you, connected to you physically with an umbilical cord that was responsible for feeding me and keeping me alive as you endured the changes of your body and your mind in preparation of my arrival. And even though that umbilical cord was cut and I am no longer attached physically, I am spiritually attached to you always, even when I am not physically here, feeling the residue of what you may be going through day in and out as my spirit intercedes for your needs. So hold on. And while you hold on, hold my hand and let me be your strength, giving you what you have given me. Resilience and victory. Remember, soldier, the battle is not yours. It's the Lord's. So keep God lifted with worship and praise on your lips. And don't forget to lift up these beautiful, beautiful hands.
Viola Corrine Evans, that's the name of my mom. And I wanted to do this documentary because there are not a lot of women who have their stories told. And I'm talking about the kind of women who are hardworking women, who are loyal to their families, loyal to their children, love raising their kids, love loving on their husbands, and really make up the fabric of America, hardworking women. And it's really nothing against the women who are the CEOs or own multiple companies or they're managing multi-million dollar payrolls. But my mom, she was to me like Superwoman. Even though she didn't own a cape, she didn't have boots or a suit, she made magically a little turn into a lot. And that really has been throughout all of my life. My mom has found a way to do things out of love, to make sure we have what we needed. And at the time, it didn't feel like it was a little. It didn't feel like it was not enough. Even though we were surrounded by other kids that had more or didn't necessarily have more, my mom always made us feel like we were good.
Doing this festival, that's the time that our family always get together. And we had the deck out there, and that used to be party central. I mean, party central. I mean, we would dance all day long, and she was my partner. She was my partner. I remember one time we went to the NCO club. I can't remember what we was there for, but a bunch of us was there, and me and her danced the whole night.
What I remember about my sister Viola, I knew at the time, I was so young, but I knew she went to Hopkins Elementary, it was the middle, and Hopkins High School. I know this is where she was a cheerleader. They were so good. I can remember even singing some of their cheerleader songs. even around the house.
And Viola, John, they were all track stars. She was softball, excellent softball player. My brother John was an excellent baseball, basketball, football player. And, you know, and those two, John and Viola, were almost like identical twins. The way they ran, they had the same running style, the same posture. When they played baseball, they threw the ball the same. I mean, it was just amazing how much they mimicked each other.
And my mom was extraordinary on that field. Not only when she hit home runs, but I didn't realize how fast my mom was as far as sprinting. She was extremely fast. I mean, she would hit the ball, she would fly around the diamonds like, you know, she was a world track star. But and you know, she would win these all the time. I have multiple trophies of her, softball trophies. Like, she was extremely athletic.
She really taught me what it meant to care for children. And to be a wife and a mom, mm-hmm. because I cared for her children. So that's the first thing that I think about. And then the second thing that I think about is really just how real she was. Oh, yeah. And so yes. Non-judgmental.
Yeah.
You know, as a teenager growing up, you know, I could always talk to her about things that I was thinking about doing or mm-hmm. things that I wanted to do.
Yeah.
And she was never one to judge me in that. She was never one to say, you shouldn't do that. What she would make me think about, okay, so if you did that, did you ever consider this? But never one to say you shouldn't do that or that's wrong.
And a love for her family, no question. She loved her family, she loved her husband. And she would do any and everything to make sure that their happiness with them was met. And that gave me a sense of family ship, so to speak. So when I got married and had my family, you know, I wanted to make sure that they got everything they needed and to make sure that they had all the tools they needed to be successful in life. Sometimes, you know, things work out, sometimes they don't. But that's life.
No, I told her I had lemonade and fruit punch.
Because who made the homemade lemonade? You or
mommy?
I did. Okay.
So she said, I want me some lemonade.
Mm-hmm.
So I fixed her food, just not a lot, but just regular portions. And she cleaned her entire plate.
Mm.
So she said, oh, that was very good. So we talked about, and it was actually that Saturday coming up was going to be my son's prom. He was 16 years old, wanted me to rent him a car from Enterprise Rental Car, but of course you have to be 21. So we were listening to the conversation. She was like, LeBron, she said, well, I have a brand new Chrysler 300. She said, he can drive my car to the prom.
Mm.
I was like, no. She said, yeah, I have full coverage. He can drive my car to the prom.
And she said, I can spend the night.
Yeah, she said, I can spend the night. And so.
Take food, bring back food. Mm. I always have the kids, always. Or we stay here just so we can be with the kids, you know?
Yeah.
Delphine came to some of my football games, two in particular. First one was against Airport, and I caught my first interception. And my mom and Delphine, out of the whole crowd, I heard my mom and Delphine scream the loudest. It just made me feel so good, that kind of support that I had from her.
I remember going to, we call it the front office. I worked in engineering somewhere in the back of the plant. And so Viola was working engineering in the front. And I would go up there occasionally, who's sitting in the president's office, legs crossed with a cup of coffee, but Viola. And this is the president of FM Manufacturing.
Remember that time we went to the football game in Atlanta. Oh, all of us couples, we went and we were going to tailgate. We grilling in the parking lot. And then we go into the game and we look at each other for 5 minutes and we say, hey, we going back to the parking lot. Yeah. That's where the party was.
Viola was close to Louise, so.
Yes, we were very, very close. Mm-hmm. We used to go up there every weekend. We would play cards, cook, and eat, and just have a good time. Mm-hmm. All the time, every weekend, so.
I remember I'd go see her, go visit her way up in Newcastle. Mm-hmm. And she said, you come by yourself? I said, yeah. I said, she said, who with you? I said, nobody. I said, I come to see you. I said, now fix me something to eat. You go in the kitchen and fix me something to eat. She said, I guess you want a drink now. And I said, that's right. That's next. Me and her sit down and talk, eat and drink. Laugh at each other, tell jokes and all that, you know.
My mother was one of those people who had a way of finding humor in every situation. You know, there were times I would call her and I might have been down and out. And she had a way of just making every situation funny, regardless of how serious it was. And I miss that about her. And I guess I have a little bit of that in me.
When they see that you care about yourself and you care about them and it's genuine, that actually, you know, makes people feel good about themselves. And if they are in any kind of situation where they feel like depression is coming on or anxiety or whatever, you know, that helped me throughout my life. Just knowing that she had that kind of ability to soothe and to hold things together despite if things were falling apart or crumbling. She knew how to put it back together effortlessly.
I used to thoroughly enjoy going to her games, and my mom was the one that would hit home run every time. And that was the most amazing thing to me to witness and experience, and I still have fond memories to this day. I can remember like yesterday, just leaving the park and kicking up the sand and going home at night and just patting her on the back and congratulating her. And she just thoroughly enjoyed it. She was so passionate about softball. And that was something I enjoyed being a part of as a child, going to her games, because I used to love to see her hit the ball and hit a home run, and then we'd all stand up and scream and cheer until she came in to home base. And it was just an amazing experience.
To not be around. Mm-hmm. You never
and love
to
not
be around. And love to
and
feed you.
And will feed you.
Love to feed
she
you.
She will feed you.
Yes.
When we come over there and she will fix the whole breakfast.
Yes, everything.
It will be so good.
Just one of a kind. Mm-hmm. Really. She was just one of a kind. Just beautiful spirit. Everybody I ever took to meet her was like, wow, your sister is so cool. Mm-hmm. You know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, she was
She's one of a kind.
You don't meet people like that
anymore. Mm-hmm. Most beautiful person that I've ever met. I mean, just wonderful.
And we miss her so much. That laugh, that smile, that joy, those
attitude.
Jokes.
Yeah.
And I would go to school thinking I was all that because I had strains in my ear. Mm. And the little girls used to fight me because I was like, my sister did my ear, she ain't doing yours. This is my sister. Then I got the real earrings in there. Oh, Lord, I used to fight for real then because I'd be like, she's not doing your ears.
But Viola actually did everybody's.
I know, I'm in the community. She did.
You know, we inevitably at some point in our lives take a little piece of our parents and it just becomes us. But just want to say that I miss my mom dearly. I think about her every single day. I can't wait for the moment when we reunite in heaven and I see her again. And until that moment comes, I just want her legacy to live on. She has so many family members and friends still here that love her dearly, and we have all these wonderful memories to share and to cherish.
you know, until we see her again. So just want to say, you know, I love you, Mom, from the bottom of my heart, and I look forward to seeing you again.
I think I was about 8 or 9 years old, and we were in our old house. We used to live in a house in Winslow, and I was in the bed sleeping. I can't remember what time it was. I was in the bed, and the way the house was set up, my room was right here, and then my door was right here, and you look out into the hallway, and then my mom's room was right here, and that was her door right there. So it was like, if I look out, this would be the hallway door, and if I look out the door, I would see, I could look into her room. So I was in bed sleeping one night, and something told me to turn over. I don't know what it was, but I had turned over to look out my door, and I saw somebody peeking around the corner. So it looked like my mom, but you know, it also looked like Grandma Viola. I wasn't sure, but they were just peeking around the corner, smiling at me, and I remember this so vividly. I don't know if it was fake or if I was just seeing things, but I'm pretty certain I wasn't just seeing anything. So I was looking around the corner, and I got scared, and I pulled my covers over my head, and I was just shaking under the covers for like 5 minutes, and I was like, oh my God, like, what is going on? So I pulled my covers back off, and they were still standing there. They had came out the doorway at this point. They were no longer peeking around the corner. They were standing in the door smiling at me, and she had a scarf tied around her head, whoever it was. I believe it was Grandma Viola, but she had a scarf tied around her head, and she was just smiling. So I just stared for a couple of minutes, and like I said, I was still scared at this point, but I was kind of interested because I was like, who is this looking at me, like, around the corner this late at night? So eventually they just went away because I had turned over in the other direction and turned back around and they were gone. So the next morning I went down into the kitchen and I saw my mama down there, and I was like, were you peeking around the door at me last night, just looking at me? And she was like, what are you talking about? And I was like, were you looking at me last night outside of your doorway? And she was just like, no. And she said it might have been Grandma Viola.
Ooh, that on Polo Road one time. Yeah. That's where I went with her a couple of times down there. Yeah. She used to love playing softball.
She would always be the cleanup person. Yeah.
If she wasn't playing softball, she was singing to you.
Mm-hmm.
She had to sing.
As a matter of fact, Viola would call me every birthday. And she would sing, happy birthday. She would sing that song to me. And the last year she called me and she sang that song, I just cried and cried. And she said, Dad, what is wrong? I said, why are you crying? I said, because this is the best birthday I ever had, because I didn't think you were going to be here. She had been ill during that time. And so I just cried. And so the next year, after she passed, phone rang on my birthday. Happy birthday. And I was so taken back, it just took me, I couldn't fathom what was going on. And I said, who is this? And Kenya said, Mom, it's me. I said, what? I said, why, you never had done that before. Why did you do that? I said, Viola is the only one that ever did that. I always sing on my birthday. She said, I don't know why, I just decided.
And before that, while she was eating, Anthony, my husband, was talking to her. And he said, Auntie, how you doing? You look good. And she said, I'm good, but I'm just so tired. I'm just so tired. Mm-hmm. And we just thought a lot was going on that weekend. She was tired from that.
Yeah. And you know, and the day she chose to come down here for Mother's Day, Daphne and several of her other friends begged her to come to their house on Mother's Day. She said, no, I'm going to my sister's house. Mm-hmm. And now as we look back on the reflections, she knew in her heart that that was going to be the last time she would see us.
Mm. Okay, girl. What you're not going to do is have me to mess up the makeup that we spent time on. Okay, cut that out. So going back to November, I want to say it was the year before she passed. Uncle Joe was working, I think, second shift. I know he was tired. Charlene wasn't here. She was in Greenville. Dwayne, you know, everybody had their own thing. I was closer to her, so I would go and try to spend time with Uncle Joe, just try to give him a break. So the weekend of my anniversary, November the 17th, I called him and said, you know, want me to come over there and help? He said, yeah, please. I just need a little break. So shooting, so. So that Saturday, went over there and helped out with her, fixed something to eat. She was in a wheelchair, or she's in a chair sitting up in the living room. And he took a nap and I fixed her something to eat and tried to feed her. She was just tired, just sitting there kind of napping. And it got late and I tried to talk to her and she was getting real sleepy. She was like really slumping over. So I said, Auntie, I'm gonna help you get from the chair to the couch. When she wasn't able to help get herself up, and I was like, I can't wake him up because he's tired. So the way the living room is set up, there's enough room to get her from the wheelchair to the couch. And I prayed for strength to get her. I lifted her up and put her on the couch. And that was that Saturday. And she laid there, and Uncle Joe got up later and wanted to know how she was doing. I said, she hadn't eaten a whole lot. I said, if she's not like this, if better in the morning, you need to go ahead and call 911 and get her to the hospital. And he called me 1 o'clock Sunday morning. He said, I gotta take her to the hospital. She's not breathing right. And took her down to, I think it was Baptist, downtown. Maybe it was Richland. I think it was Richland she was in. What hospital did she go to?
Baptist
downtown. And I got over there. They was putting her back in the EMS, and I went home and called mom and everybody and got to the hospital. And before they could pull her back into surgery, I talked to the doctor, and he said, your aunt's not doing good. And he said, but I'm going to try to do my best to clean her insides out. She got a issue. Then called mommy and Aunt Faye, and everybody kind of came up there, and she stayed in the hospital between two hospitals and rehab, 9 months total?
Almost a year.
So I can remember the night before Mama died, I was the last person to talk to her. You know, I was calling my mama to tell her about a guy she had met that I was dating, and we ended up breaking up. So Mama was consoling me the night before she died, and just being who she was, trying to just encourage me to keep on keeping on. It was okay. And it was just a special moment I had with her. And like any other time we would get off the phone, she told me that she loved me. I told her I loved her. And I'm just so grateful. It's amazing because those last conversations got a full-fledged memory bank of years with my mama. But you know, the thought that I think about the most is the last conversation I had with her. And that was such an amazing, beautiful, peaceful, lovable conversation. I'll always remember that. It's a great thought. And I'm just so grateful to God that that was our last conversation and the way it all played out. But that next day, going to work and getting a phone call about Mama dying was also a phone call I will never forget. And that whole morning was a blur. And then heading to Columbia from Greenville, South Carolina. I don't even remember the ride, but I'm grateful for coworkers who basically took care of me that whole day, drove me down to Columbia to be with my family. It was a very hard day, very, very surreal day. But you know, what can you say? I wouldn't take back everything that she's left me at this point leading up to that last night. I have things that I've learned from my mom that is going to be a part of my life for the rest of my life. That I'm grateful for.
I'm just happy to be a part of this. In memory of I, and I just cherish the moment. I cherish life. I cherish people. If you can do anything in life, a person, make good memories. Make good memories. That'll be a part of my legacy or anybody else.
And I learned so much from her and her personality. We really have similar personalities. That is the reason why we bumped heads all the time. But I know my mom lives inside of me. Everything that I do, even how I think as it relates to people, business, family, friends, I have that nurturing spirit, that thing I love so much about my mom. I have that in me, and I hear all the, you know, a lot that, gosh, you remind me of your mom. And that to me is one of the highest compliments ever that I could be given. My mom was simple too. She lived vicariously through me. I'm the traveler. I'm always gone. I'm on planes all the time. And she was the first phone call I made before getting on a plane. And she was the first phone call I made when I got off. And that first year that she died, I would never forget it, because that was the very first year that I flew to India. International trip, vacation, visiting a girlfriend. And I pulled my phone out to call my mom, and I forgot that my mom is not here. But it was just so many things I had to try to retrain myself to do in her absence. And even the trip going to India was just so like my mom's spirit. That second leg headed into Mumbai, the plane had over 200 passengers, and most of the people on the plane were foreigners. Most of the people were Indians, and they were heading into India. And it was one black lady on the plane. And while we were going through security, I can remember saying to myself, I wonder why she's going to India. She probably was thinking the same thing about me. So we get on the plane, and out of all these passengers, guess who I was sitting next to? The black lady on the plane. And it was such a divine setup. This woman nurtured me. She was around the age of my mom. She talked to me about India. She had been to India and walked me through the whole process. And once I got off the plane, she helped me through customs. She helped me exchange my money, and we exchanged phone numbers. And she told me, when you get back to Atlanta, because she was living in Atlanta at the time, then, you know, reach out to me and I'll be there for you. Just, you feel like a daughter. And that was the last time I saw that woman. I tried calling her multiple times. I never was able to reach her, and I said, she was an angel for sure. But my mom continues to be that angel for me throughout my life, throughout all the things that I do. Constantly talking to her, I'm constantly thinking about her. And I wanted to leave something to honor her life, to honor who she was as a woman to the world. She left such an amazing mark. She was known to be that light. And I just wanted to shed some light on this kind of woman. I think that we can see this kind of woman through multiple women in our families. And their stories are not told. They're not giving publicity. They're not giving attention. And I just wanted to give some attention. And it had to come through my mom, Viola Evans. And hey, that's what it had to come down to. But I'm honored to do this. This might be the most difficult, most rewarding, and most amazing passion project that I think I've ever done and ever will do. And I'm grateful for the opportunity. I'm grateful for the resources to be able to do this. I'll cherish this for the rest of my life, and I really hope that every person that watches this video and every family member who can remember my mom and who have contribute to this documentary, that you will help somebody see or witness to just an amazing individual.